got the wind down, and you got your seat laid back. Ain't even made it halfway to town, and you're already talking about a six-pack. Already got your shoes off, and you're talking about slipping off. No, we ain't even found your friends, and you already want to get lost.
Hello.
All right, hello, good morning, everybody. We want to thank everybody for coming out here today. We're getting kind of accustomed to seeing you guys each week, so we'll be in touch with you about next week's press conference and see what we have going on. Real quick question, has anybody heard any rumors last couple of days? He's farming corn. So with that said, while we have enjoyed the talk and the rumors, we actually are here, and we actually do have a super important announcement that we are very pleased with. Up here joining me today to give you this announcement, I have Steve Newmark. He's the president of Roush Fenway Racing. I have Elliot Hamlish. He is the VP of Worldwide Loyalty and Partnerships at Wyndham Hotel Group. And we all know 2019 Hall of Fame nominee Jack Roush. Hint, hint.
Thanks, Kevin. Thanks for you guys for coming out again. I know we coerced a lot of you to come out to our shop last week for the announcement about the extension of Fastenal, Fifth Third, and Sunny D, and we thought we'd continue some of the positive momentum, give you another hopefully good story about where Roush is and the direction for this sport. So we really appreciate you guys taking the time and joining us. Now, we know this being NASCAR, secrets don't seem to say secrets very long, but we're actually pretty pleased that through all the speculation that we were able to keep a major part of this announcement under the radar screen, and that it was not something that there was a revelation on social media or articles about, and that is the introduction of an incredible company into our sport and into the Roush Fenway family and the NASCAR family as a whole. I think everybody in here is familiar that partners are the lifeblood of our sport. Unlike any other U.S. professional sport, we don't exist. We don't get to go to the racetrack. We don't get to entertain unless we maintain relationships with strong brands and integrate them into everything that we do, which is why we're so excited to introduce Wyndham Rewards, Wyndham Hotels into our family. I think they're going to resonate quite a bit with the NASCAR fan base. I would speculate that they are probably the only sponsor in our sport with whom each one of you guys, through all your travels, has slept in one of their beds. And this was something that I learned through this process, that they are the largest hotel operator in the world. So they're literally everywhere in the U.S. And of course, most importantly for us, they are everywhere that we go. And Elliot's going to talk a little bit more about those details, but we think it's pretty exciting because we know we'll be able to engage the NASCAR fan base with a lot of creative activities, because every time we go to the track, you'll see their properties. So again, wanted to welcome Wyndham Rewards, Wyndham Hotels, and their 8,000 associates into our family and into the NASCAR industry. So with that, Elliot, I'll pass it off to you.
Well, fantastic. And before I jump in, I saw a number of folks smiling and nodding, having stayed at our hotel, so that means we're already off to a good start. So thank you so much, Kevin, Steve, Jack. Couldn't be more excited about this opportunity, and really appreciate everybody coming out today. So I'm guessing that many of you have heard of Wyndham before. What you may not know is that Wyndham Hotel Group is in fact the largest hotel operator in the country, as Steve mentioned. We've got more than 8,000 hotels spanning 20 brands across 80 countries globally. And many of these brands have become really iconic household names that many of you have likely heard of before. Brands like Days Inn, Super 8, Ramada, and Howard Johnson, all of which we are incredibly proud of. And one of the aspects that makes me most proud to work for Wyndham Hotel Group is that we really have a hotel at every single price point in the market for every customer. So if you're on your way to Bristol, you get tired in the evening and you need a place to rest, we've got a roadside hotel for you. If you're on a family vacation down in Daytona the week before the 500, we've got a resort on the beach in Florida for you. And it's really that aspect of working for the company that really gets me so excited. Now, what unites all of those together is our award-winning Wyndham Rewards program. And the program is premised on pretty extensive customer research that we did, in which we learned that what our customers want most is a straightforward program. They were getting tired of the programs that were overly complicated, hard to understand, not sure how to earn my points, not sure how to redeem my points. And so we really premised the program on three core premises. Number one, a program that was simple. Number two, a program that was generous. And number three, a program that was aspirational in nature. So on the simplicity front, we were the first in the industry to introduce a flat redemption rate. So 15,000 points gets you a free night at any one of our hotels globally. Number two, generosity. When our members stay at our hotels, they earn 10 points for every dollar spent with a minimum of 1,000 points. And number three, aspirational. I'm proud to say that we have 25,000 plus aspirational redemption options, extending outside of our hotels to include homes and condos as well. Really redemption options for every type of customer. And it's with that customer in mind, we like to call it the everyday customer. We have 55 million members of the Wyndham Rewards program. And one of the aspects of this partnership that I am most excited about is thinking about the demographic overlap with our 55 million Wyndham Rewards members and the 80 million plus fans of NASCAR. And if you think about that overlap, it really is an endless amount of opportunity and upside associated with this partnership. Not only being able to engage our existing 55 million customers in a sport that we know they love and are passionate about, but at the same time, introducing the Wyndham Rewards program to NASCAR fans that may not know about it today. And so it's with that that I am just thrilled to be here today. Again, I want to extend a really dear thanks to Jack, to Steve, to Kevin, on behalf of the Wyndham Rewards family, and really appreciate it. Thank you.
Absolutely. I think that you know, one of the things when we were having our discussion that resonated quite a bit with us, and I think will resonate with the fans, is if you look at where Wyndham's footprint is, they have, on average, 20 hotels within a short distance of every single track. So all 23 tracks, you got, you know, 470-odd hotels there. So I think we already have a pretty nice match, and we'll hopefully have some fun with that.
All right, with that, what we're going to do is we're going to come in here, we're going to take some pictures with the unveiling of the new show car, and we'll take questions after that.
Why don't we hold for a second, and I think we've got probably another announcement that we'll couple with this.
Okay, we'll have another announcement. I'll stand down here.
I'm going to direct you guys that direction. So you guys are still looking up here, but...
The first driver of the number six car and NASCAR Hall of Fame member, Mark Martin.
Were you guys expecting someone else? Oh, man. You know, just because you walk away from the race car for a while doesn't mean you're done forever. I had some of the best years of my life driving the number six car for Jack Roush, and it really feels cool to be hanging out up here with you guys today. You know, it seems like just yesterday, back, it was 1987, Jack Roush and I were with a group like you guys announcing, you know, our intentions and our new deal. Moving forward about 12 years to 1999, I had the great privilege of introducing a really fine up-and-coming race car driver to Jack Roush. And from there, I think the rest is history. You know, with that, I would like to introduce the new driver of the Jack Roush number six Ford. I had a lot to do with bringing him here 20 years ago, and I'm really, really excited to introduce him today. NASCAR champion, Matt Kenseth.
Here he comes, Winston Cup win number one in the Coca-Cola 600 for Wisconsin's Matt Kenseth.
The dark horse from Cambridge, Wisconsin, this Badger just kept digging.
I can't thank Mark Martin and Jack Roush enough for this opportunity.
Cup champion, the official celebration, as is tradition after the final race.
This is great. This is Matter. He's earned it, and they're going to win a bunch more of them.
2009 champ, Matt Kenseth in a backup car, slipping through for the lead. And
congratulations.
Matt Kenseth.
Thanks. Everybody thought Mark was coming out of retirement. It's great to be here today. Obviously, it's a big day, I think, for Roush Fenway Racing. Big day for me and my family. It's great to bring a new sponsor to the sport with Wyndham Rewards. I'm real proud to be able to drive the six car. You know, funny story, when I started at Roush Fenway and Mark kind of met him at Talladega way back in 97, and he kind of went to Jack and said, hey, I think this is a new young guy. By the way, I'm still pretty young. And I think we need to get him in here. And as it went on for a year or so, you know, Mark is like, look, I'm not going to do this much longer. And, you know, when I get out of the six car, I really want you to take over and drive the six car. So that was the plan. And I think I was maybe 24 or 5 at the time. And if I would have waited for him to get out and retire, I would have been about 39 my rookie year. So it took a lot longer than we thought, but I'm proud to be driving a six car, looking forward to going to Kansas, and obviously it means a lot to me to reunite with everybody at Roush Fenway Racing, and I'm really looking forward to the challenge, and really looking forward to getting to work soon. So thanks, Jack. Thanks, Steve, everybody, for getting this deal together. Mark, appreciate it.
Thanks, guys. My comments will be brief. I want to start by thanking Winston Kelly and all the folks at the Hall of Fame here for giving us this great venue. Thanks to the Wyndham Rewards for coming to us and for the long hours you spent in the recent days putting the contract together and making all that work for the first time. And welcome to the partnerships we've had that in the sport that we're very proud of that sponsor our cars. Mark came down from Batesville this morning. It was a surprise to me a couple days ago when I found that he was going to be able to come. That's great. The linkage between Mark and Matt is very strong. Mark approached me in 1998, I think. And 98, I think it was 98, and said that he had this been having a conversation with this Busch Grand National driver, rookie driver that was worked hard on his cars and thought about racing like he did, and we thought it would be a good place for him to join us and to work with Mark. Mark thought he could help him, and he would seem to be worth the trouble. And so we had 2 years in the Xfinity program, which was the Busch Grand National program, I think, still at that time. And then we moved him directly into the 17 car in the Cup Series for 12 years. We won 24 Cup races and 9 Xfinity races in that time frame, and had a great success. And I'm anxious to get back on track and win some more races. The other thing we think that Matt will do is give us a chance to mentor with some of our drivers, that young rookie drivers, and also Trevor and Ricky, for the benefit of his experience that was passed, some of which was passed to him from Mark. So thanks to Mark and thanks for Matt. Look forward to the future, and we're going to make our team and our race cars great again.
Elliot, can you talk about the partnership and having Matt on board in the car?
Yeah, we are just incredibly excited about this opportunity, really for a couple of reasons. Number one, great to be a part of Matt's comeback. So. That first and foremost is just incredibly exciting to us. And second, just getting to know the Roush Fenway team, it's been a number of months now. And I'll give you even an indication from 5 minutes ago, I saw Matt walk in with his family and he was holding the baby's car seat. And just that image, I've got two small kids, just the family nature of this team is something that resonated so soundly with us. It very much feels that way at Wyndham Hotel Group as well. So we're thrilled. What an amazing opportunity. And again, thanks to the team. Thanks to Matt for your hospitality and allowing us for the opportunity to have this partnership.
All right, what we're going to do now is we're going to ask Matt and his family, Katie back there, and Elliot we're going to unveil the number 6 Wyndham Rewards Ford Fusion.
They're probably going to want their picture by Lightning McQueen, but I'll try to get them over to the show car.
Once we're done with a couple of pictures here, we're going to bring everybody back up and take questions. We'll take questions when Matt gets finished taking pictures with Lightning McQueen. All right, we'll open it up. Claire B.
Claire B. Lang, Sirius XM NASCAR Radio. Can one of you talk about how this program will work? It'll be a full schedule. It'll be shared. How will it work? How will it play out?
Sure, I'll grab that, Claire. Thanks for the question. The intent is for this to be a shared program with both Trevor and Matt continuing in the car for the rest of the year. To us, this is an incredible opportunity. I mean, it's not only special for us to reunite Matt and Jack and to have Wyndham help us reunite another family, but we look at Matt as the best in the business at helping to assess and diagnose and figure out how to make cars better. And so our goal is to continue to race for wins and championships, and we think Matt gives us a great opportunity to do that and will help Trevor, Ricky, and all of our young guys in Xfinity. But as far as the details on how it'll be split with Trevor and Matt, that's still being worked out. We know Matt will be in his first race in Kansas coming up, and Trevor will be obviously in the car this weekend and next weekend, and then we'll be working through some of those details. And I know a lot of that stuff is of interest. The number of races and all that stuff, we'll be announcing kind of which ones will be the Wyndham races. They've got a significant number going forward. And we've obviously got a couple great partners already on the car with Advocare and Performance Plus that we're working through. So our focus right now is bringing back Matt into the fold and seeing how he can help us become a better organization.
Questions? Bob?
Over here. Bob Pockers, ESPN. Can you say, will he do the All-Star race?
Matt will be in the All-Star race, yes.
Yes, sir.
Jacob Seelman, Speed Sport. Matt, first off, I guess, welcome home. Second, when you stepped out of the JGR car last year, you said you would come back if the opportunity felt right. Roush feels right. What are you excited about coming home in this situation?
Well, I mean, I'm excited about all of it. So, I mean, yeah, it's not like from, middle of last year till now, there hasn't been any opportunities to go do some things, but it just, you kind of know when something feels right, and certainly to come back and hopefully help Jack, who has done so much, obviously, for my career, hopefully, get Roush Fenway Racing, running better again, and I feel like they've definitely been trending in the right direction. Ricky won a couple races last year at the Restricted Plate Tracks, and like I said, certainly I feel like RFR is on the upswing. I think it's a good challenge for me that I'm really looking forward to, and really not just the driving part, but a lot of the rest of it too, to hopefully get in there and get my hands dirty and try to evaluate what we can do better and what we're doing good, what we can do better, and to go on from there. So just really all of it, the timing. I know to you guys might seem weird, but the timing was right. And it was the right deal. Exciting to bring Wyndham on board, bringing a new sport and a sponsor, or a new sponsor and sport at the same time. And it just all lined up, and seemed like the right thing at the right time.
I haven't been asked a question, but I want to answer a question that's worthwhile here. When I contacted Matt to see if he had an interest in getting involved with our limited program with the objectives that we've set forth, his question to me is, why did it take so long for me to call? Why did it take me so long? Well, I had still a little bit of a rawness over the fact that he left me when he did, and that we had another championship out there I thought that we could have had in short order, and I missed that, so it took me a little while to get over that.
All right, Jerry, front.
Jerry Jordan, Kicking the Tires, .net, PRN. Matt, you also said last year that you didn't really have a choice in leaving. You stayed away from the retirement word and said that you had a few more years behind you. When you got the call from Jack, what was your reaction? What through your head to get to the point we're at now?
Well, I mean, like I said, it feels like the right deal at the right time. It's with I've already said this, but it's with Jack. I think it's an interesting challenge for me, and not just being a driver. I hope that I can be much more to the organization, and I'm hoping that there's a lot of different ways I can help in. I don't know that I can, but I hope that there is, and that's kind of what I'm looking forward to. It's fairly small right now, down to two teams, and it's leaner, and I feel like they're on the right trajectory. I feel like there's a lot of advantages to where they're at right now. And I'm looking forward to getting in there and being part of it and getting back, immersed in an organization and kind of hopefully evaluate some things. Hopefully, continue the thing projecting upwards.
Is it safe to say this is longer than 1 year?
I mean, there's a lot of things we're working through right now. We kind of got this all together, pretty quickly. But yeah, I mean, I think that's what all of our hopes is to continue this, long term, and get back to, turning TV on and seeing the Roush cars up front every week.
We see a potential role for Matt being involved with the company, the race team, past his driving. We haven't talked much about that, but certainly we feel like he's come home to us, and that he's a significant part of our history and our legacy, as is Mark. And we've had two really great drivers and great people here that have helped us build this thing, and we're anxious to keep them involved if we can going forward at some level.
Nate.
Nate Ryan, NBC Sports. Steve, just to clarify that on the deal, are you guys saying multi-year deal, or is it just the rest of the season? Do you guys have any terms?
Well, Nate, as you know, we generally don't get into the details of the contract, but our view is that Matt will be with us for as long as we can. I think him and Jack have forged a pretty strong relationship, and our goal is to have Matt continuing to drive until he no longer has that desire, and knowing Matt, that will be for many years into the future.
Still two cars for the foreseeable future?
That is correct.
And what happens with Trevor Bayne in terms of his races? We know he has a tight relationship with Advocare. Is he driving the Advocare races only?
We're still in process of working through which races. I mean, our goal is to have Trevor continue to grow and mature on the track. As you guys know, he's one of the highest character guys in the garage, and we're proud of having him as part of our family. He will continue to be in the car, and we hope that Matt's assistance with all of this will elevate not only Trevor's performance, Ricky's performance, but we haven't delineated all of the different races and who will be in what race. We've obviously been in contact with our partners and with Trevor, and we've got an open dialogue about how all that will sort out. And we'll try to do it in a way that gives us the best opportunity to excel on the track. So we'll look at different races, different tracks, where we need help, and where we can probably utilize Matt's skill set the best.
Mike?
Steve or Jack, an obvious question here is, if Trevor should win this weekend and qualify for the playoffs, would you come in with a third car to keep him driving for the year to stay in the playoff situation, or how would that work?
I know what Jack would answer, so I'm going to jump and grab the mic here, is that that's a problem that we hope that we have after this weekend. Obviously, our cars have been really good. We won last year with this race with the 17, so we'd be thrilled if either the 6 or the 17 wins the race this weekend, and that would be a great problem to be facing on Sunday.
Kenny Bruce with KennyBruce.net. For Mark, you've been down this road before, sort of what Matt's looking at, coming in trying to help a team get back on its feet, running a partial schedule. Have you given him any tips or told him about, okay, these are hurdles that you're going to face because you're not coming in running full time?
No, I haven't. Matt is not someone that would need any tips from me. That's why he is my favorite driver. So if he did, he would. He does know my phone number. He usually texts though, but I would say he won't need that. It's, you know, we're talking about Matt Kenseth here.
I'd like to cut the chase on a couple of questions here that might be coming. If you asked why is Mark here and why is he so reveled in our history and why is Matt here, they were the best two guys at really finding the speed in their cars. They have all the things that a car does. These stock cars are not very easy to drive, and they do three or four things that would drive a professional driver to have tears around the lap. There's three or four things that they do every lap that you really want to fix. There's one or two of them that you can address and find speed in the car, and if you address the others, you don't. These are the best two guys that I've had of the 50 drivers that we've worked with in NASCAR to find the speed in the cars. Both make the recommendations to the team for hardware changes, and for the things they faced behind the steering wheel to make the right choices for the things they brought to the attention to the crew chief.
Jenna.
Jenna Fryer, AP. Matt, you've been tasked with helping find speed in the car and rebuild the organization, but how much of you is going to want to get in that car and go win races and show everybody what they passed up on?
Oh, man, I've been doing this for a long time. I don't really feel like I have anything to prove. I don't. I mean, obviously, every time you get in a race car and you go to the racetrack, you want to be your best, and you go there with the idea of trying to win. And that's never going to change as long as I drive. I would say that this opportunity is probably as much about the rest of it, the rest of my role, possible future role, than it is just the driving. You know, if it was just strictly about driving, I probably would have been at Daytona, you know, driving something. It's more about the rest of it. It's more about coming here and trying to help, coming and seeing what the farther out future looks like for me, 3 or 4 or 5 years down the road, if it's something I'm good at, trying to help in the shop, trying to just kind of see what it's like. You know, like I said, it's smaller than what it once was. I feel like I can be a real asset in a lot of different ways besides just driving. I hope that turns out to be true. So it's as much about that as it really is driving the race cars. But I'm really competitive, obviously, with whatever I do. And if I'm not in the car, there's nothing I want more than Ricky or Trevor to be out there running up front and improving and doing better and working hard at it and hopefully being successful.
Bob Hocker, ESPN. For Jack, is this a move that you feel you wanted to make to win races soon, or is this a move to kind of evaluate your cars and where they're at?
It's all of that. You know, it's a chance to look at our cars and find out if there's something glaring that Matt would see from his experience, which would be in line with what Mark's impression would be if he were in the cars, I think, as well. I'm anxious to have that impression, but we're also anxious to start building back on the 33 races that Matt's won in Xfinity as well as Cup, and add to that whether there's another championship in there for Matt with Roush Fenway, that remains to be seen. That's in years 2 and 3 out. If there is a year in 2 and 3 for Matt in the car, we'll just have to see how it goes.
Yeah, the Whistler kickingthetires.net. Matt Windham's tagline is, you've earned this. Do you feel like you've earned this after all that went down last year? And Steve, do you feel like you guys have earned this, having Matt Kenseth come back to the organization?
I don't really know how to answer that question exactly. I mean, I feel like as long as I've been in the sport, I've never really been totally comfortable, I guess, or, you know, comfortable with your job, or however you want to look at it. And I think everybody, every driver, every personality, there's something different, I think, that makes them, you know, unique, or drives them, or makes them successful, or whatever. And for me, it's just never being comfortable, never feeling like I'm near good enough, and I need to be doing better, and, you know, figuring out what you can do better, and moving on from there. So I don't know that, you know, I guess, you know, that'd be a better question for those guys, whether you earned it. I don't know if you necessarily earned it, but certainly I go out every week and do my very best, you know, from, you know, Monday through Sunday, and that's something that never changes with me. And I guess that was, you know, I decided to go do this. We had some conversations, and you know, I really had to put a lot of thought into it, because I don't think I've ever been happier and more content than I've been the last 6 months, honestly. So you know, to go back, and I know how I operate. I'm not going to go just ride around or just show up on Sunday and race. I'm going to put, you know, all my effort into this and a lot of time into this. So I had to make sure I was ready to go do that, which I am. You know, I'm looking forward to, like I told you, getting back and seeing what kind of impact I can make.
I think I would couch it a little different. I think we feel privileged that Wyndham's come on board. It's no secret that pretty much every team in the garage has been courting them, so they had no shortage of opportunities. And, you know, the fact that they elected to go with us, you know, obviously gives us a sense of pride. And we hope it's a testament to some of the things that we've been doing on and off the track with a lot of the programs and the creative social media and the activation. And it's also a testament to our relationship with the Boston Red Sox and the Fenway Sports Group. They were integral in making the connection and were with us kind of every step of the way as we tried to create programs and show Wyndham that this was the right family atmosphere, and gave them the best opportunity to connect with the entire NASCAR fan base and succeed both on and off the track.
Yeah, and I'll just jump in just to reiterate. This was a pretty straightforward decision for us as we worked with this team. It is you, the rest of the Roush Fenway organization, and of course Jack as well, really a stand-up organization. So we'd like to extend our thanks as well. Really thrilled about the opportunity and looking forward to the season ahead.
Thank you, Elliot.
Matt, Brendan Marks from the Charlotte Observer. I know you mentioned this sort of came together quickly. What was the timetable like on getting this deal together? And then also, have you had the chance to speak to Trevor or Ricky and talk about how things will be?
I didn't hear the first part about timetable.
How long did it take to sort of get this deal figured out and worked out? What was the timetable? How long ago did they reach out to you?
Oh, okay. Yeah, we've been talking for a little while, you know, and trying to get all the details worked out, and as Steve alluded to, still kind of working out some details going forward. I've not spoken to Trevor yet. I was going to give that a week or so to settle down. My hope is that, you know, after a few days when things kind of shake out, my hope is we can get together face-to-face sooner than later, hopefully next week, and sit and have a long talk, because I really feel like there's a lot of things I could probably help him with, and my hope is that he embraces that and, you know, turns this into you know, something to drive them and even get better. But I have not had that conversation with him yet. I've been trying to keep this under wraps. Did pretty good until yesterday, the day before, whenever it was. Ricky, I touched base with Ricky yesterday, you know, for a little bit, and we're planning on meeting first thing next week as well.
Jacob Seelman, Speed Sport. Mark, I couldn't help but look over the car and realize how many cues it takes from one of your last rides at Roush Fenway. What does it mean to see you, or for you to see the blue come back on the sixth car? What kind of memories does it evoke, and how special is this for you to be here?
I can't tell you what it means to me. I have been so excited, but I don't know that I can describe to you what it means to me to look at that car and know that my favorite driver of all time is going to be in that car part-time. And, you know, it is going to be working hard to improve the performance of Roush Racing. I have a lot of sweat equity and pride in this organization. After all, it was this man right here and all the great people that built that organization brick by brick that enabled me to become a part of this amazing Hall of Fame here. And I don't have the words to articulate what it means to me and what they mean to me and what that organization means to me. It's a really exciting time for me.
Well, I have one for Steve, one for Matt. Steve, when you unveiled this plan to Trevor, how did he take the news?
I think he reacted just the way any of us would predict he'd react. He's a fierce competitor. He wants to be in the car every week, not in Cup. He will drive anything. And so, you know, we continue to have a dialogue, and, you know, I think that, you know, he'll see this as an opportunity for him to continue to excel. But there's no doubt that when we had the dialogue about it, that his first reaction was that I want to be in the car every week. And that's, in fact, we wouldn't want it any other way. If we had a driver who just kind of acquiesced and said, yeah, that sounds good, I think that would be an inherent problem in itself.
And then for Matt, you mentioned your competitive spirit. I know since Miami that your life has been a lot of gymnastics meets and the like. How has your competitive spirit been the last couple of months when you've been away from the racetrack? You've been itching to get back?
Well, Nate, I was just curious, are all your blue blazers dirty? Oh, okay. They're usually navy. Never seen them anything but a navy blazer or hoodie. I can't remember what you asked me. My competitive spirit has been really good. So, yes, the kids do a lot of gymnastics, and I've spent a lot of time sitting in lobbies at the gym and going to several gymnastics meets, which we have one actually tomorrow that we're going down to tonight. So my competitive spirit is good. My four-year-old loves to play games, so I'm constantly, even when I win, she tells me I lost, which I guess that runs in the family as well. So my competitive spirit is good. Certainly have not lost any of that. I mean, I think if there's any of it you miss from racing is the competition, you know, going out there and knowing you're racing against the best stock car drivers anywhere and the best race teams, crew chiefs, engineers, and trying to figure out how to beat them. So, I mean, you know, certainly that's always the part you miss the most. Yeah, I've definitely, I mean, there's certain things, you know, you miss. There's probably a couple things you don't, but there's certainly a lot more things you miss than you don't. And, you know, competing has always been the best part. I mean, Mark can tell you that. I mean, the best part of the weekend is when you start edging on Saturday night or Sunday afternoon, whatever it is, and you get to roll off and, you know, go race those guys as hard as you can for 4 hours or whatever it is.
Chase Wilhelm, NASCAR.com. Matt, going back to a point that you and Jack talked about having a role after your driving career, is that something that you had in your head when you accepted their deal? Is that, hey, like, I can come home and have a role there past the cockpit?
Certainly that came up in some discussions, you know, for sure. I think that, you know, like I said, as much as just the driving part, I think the rest of it interests me. I mean, I think that I certainly haven't been home long enough to have been bored or like dying to go do something. I've been really busy at home. Actually, the last 6 months have went by faster than I think any 6 months of my life. It's really busy, honestly. But also, I think, you know, there's a you know, part of you that misses being part of something, especially when you've been a competitor, you know, your whole life. And obviously, you're not going to drive forever. So I think the part of still being part of something competitive and trying to make something better and trying to figure out how to do it better than the next guy and go beat everybody is still there, you know, whether you're in the car or whether you're not. So, you know, not being in it every week is certainly be different. It's something I've never done before. So I can't really tell you exactly what it's going to be like probably until I do it for a while.
I have a question for Matt and Mark. First, Matt, did you watch races? Did you watch races?
Did I watch races? I watched races, yes. I've probably watched more closely the last few weeks than I did maybe the first few weeks, but the last few weeks certainly as this came together,
been a little more involved and reading through some notes and looking through some data and watching the races a little closer, kind of seeing what's going on. Yeah.
How did it feel watching races?
It's fine. I mean, I'm trying to think how to answer it where you don't think I'm being smart. You know, it's not like I turned the TV on for Daytona 500 and it was just killing me. I wasn't in the car. It really wasn't like that at all. It's a little different just watching it. But I have watched all the races for years. I mean, you always go through it and I would always rewatch film before the next week to see what I can learn. You know, try to pick up some things that maybe you weren't thinking about or whatever to try to make yourself better for the next week. So I can't say it was really, you know, necessarily a lot different than that, except for I wasn't really taking notes.
And Mark, you've said repeatedly Matt's your favorite driver. You've worked with...
I paid him for that.
Okay.
Not a lot, because I'm really tight. He'll tell you that.
He's really tight.
I paid him a little bit.
We've heard that about him. So if you paid him, I don't need to ask the rest of the question. No, you've worked with so many drivers. You've raced against so many drivers. Why is that guy your favorite?
That's a hard one to answer. And I want to say that Jeff Burton is probably...
Speaking of tight.
Yeah. Jeff Burton is the guy who I have probably the most respect for ever. As far as race car drivers go, he helped me more than anyone ever, and he is really special to me. But what I like about Matt is a little bit different than that. I met with Matt at the driver's meeting at Talladega and had a conversation with him for 30 minutes and knew right then that he was the guy. I had heard and knew what he had been doing in Wisconsin, but I knew. And all I can say is I'm dumber than hell, and I can't explain a lot of different things. But when I met Arlene Martin, I knew. And we beat a lot of odds. And that's how I felt about him.
Whoa. This is not a proposal of any sort.
No. It's different. Oh, okay. I knew that he was the right guy.
It was going really good until you said that.
Come on, felt this. Anybody that knows me would know I wouldn't like you like that. But, you know, Matt is definitely the right guy for the job. You know, he knows about race cars. He knew about race cars then. He won races in different cars against people that I knew were hard to beat. And that told me that there wasn't a crew chief that made Matt fast and made Matt win. He knew race cars. He's enough old school to be able to bring that to the table. And yet enough new school to be able to adapt to whatever the changing... You know, racing has changed all through the years, and he's been able to adapt to the simulation, era and all this technology era and all that stuff. And how I knew that, I don't know. Maybe I just get lucky, but I knew that he was that kind of driver, the kind of driver that could do it all and adapt and change through it all. And I don't know why that is. I like his personality, the way he approaches things, and he, like Jeff Burton, are smarter than me, so I always liked being around them because if I just kept my mouth shut, I'd learn something.
The other thing about Mark and Matt is that they don't care who they yell at to get what they want. I've been taken to woodshed with both of them different times and didn't turn out in my favor.
That's true.
Dustin Long, NBC Sports. Matt, what will be the biggest challenges or concerns with missing the first 11 races before you get back in the car?
Well, I don't know necessarily about missing the first 11 races the biggest challenge. I think even if it was the start of the season, the biggest challenges for me, you know, are going to be that there's no testing, you know, so you're going to hit hit Kansas with an hour and a half of practice or whatever, get ready to qualify in a car that I've never been in with a crew chief. I've worked with Matt a little bit, but not a lot. You know, something just totally different. So I think that'll be the biggest challenge. I really think that, you know, the few extra months off, I really don't feel like it's going to be a big deal. You know, of course, I could be wrong. But I think, you know, you'll get on the track for, you know, 10 or 15 minutes and get out there and get reacclimated. And I think it's, I'm not really worried about that part. So I guess the biggest thing is just not being in the car and getting all the little things right, you know, making sure you're comfortable, you know, how you're going to relay to your crew chief information and how he's going to adjust on how you talk, you know, not working together. Some of that stuff is a learning process that takes a little bit of time. So just, that's probably the only, you know, kind of concern I guess you have, or the part where maybe you'll feel like you're maybe a little bit behind just at first, but I really don't expect it'll take very long.
I'd like to add to that too, Dustin. I don't think that I think there's zero rust, but you know, slipping into something that's completely new, like Matt said, the fit of everything, readjusting to where everything is in these cars versus the last cars that he drove, and those kind of things. And then the other part of it is that he won't have an opportunity to tailor anything about the race car going forward. In other words, every single race that you do and you come back and you go through all that is the opportunity for the whole organization to address specific issues and think through logically, how can we make this particular part of the car better? Because as you know, as these guys said before, as Jack said before, there are a number of things on a race car that you need that you can work on, but you can only fix so many things, especially at one time. And I think that having Matt in the race car will send them directly to areas that will bear fruit pretty quickly as they learn to address those and not spend a lot of time trying to address some of the ones that might not ever bear fruit. Because after all, that's what puts teams ahead of other teams. It's not because one team works that much harder than the other. They all work hard. It's just which ones work on the part on the things that bear fruit are the ones that, you know, migrate to the front.
One more right here, and we'll wrap
up. Tim Southers, Motorsport. I have two quick questions. Number one, who's going to be your spotter? Have you thought about that yet? And then secondly, will you be at the racetrack every week, even when you're not in the car, to maybe help offer advice or anything along those lines?
Yeah, the first one, you know, I'm not sure that's going to be any different than what it is now. I believe Roman Pemberton's spotting for him, so I'm not sure that's going to be any different. As far as being at the racetrack every week, that's not a discussion we've had. I don't anticipate being at the racetrack every week when I'm not racing. I anticipate being there probably some of the time. I anticipate being in all the meetings, whether I'm driving or not, and getting all that, you know, organized and figuring out how I can help with some of that stuff, I guess. Not that it's not organized, but organizing where I can be there too and be with Trevor and Ricky for the weekends I'm not in the car and kind of try to see what they're going through and see if there's some ways I can help.
Okay, thank you very much. We're going to do some photos by the car down here, and then we will be happy to accommodate whatever individual needs you have with any of these five gentlemen on the stage. Just see myself or any of our communication staff, we'll work it out.